Good afternoon. Good afternoon and welcome to the second lecture as part of the faculty exchange program and the first lecture with St. Teresa's College, Ernakulam. I am Kuku Seria, faculty coordinator of the exchange program from All Saints College and also an alumna of St. Teresa's College, Ernakulam. Today our speaker will be Dr. Sonia J. Nayar, Assistant Professor and Head, Department of English, All Saints College. She has presented papers in various national and international seminars and has various publications to her credit. She is also a well-known poet and also the editor of a portal for poetry called samyuktapoetry.com. Today she will be giving you an introduction to posthumanism.
Good afternoon and thank you, Kuku, and thank you, St. Teresa's College, for entering into this collaborative venture with us. And through the process of this faculty exchange program, we hope to exchange valuable information, knowledge sharing, and also create a suitable interface for our students to exchange ideas, as well as to lead to greater and better collaborative ventures. So that's the idea basically over here. Now, let me just share my screen. I hope the screen is visible to everybody.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. So introducing posthumanism, and let me tell you, it is not going to be an easy task at all, because posthumanism, you must understand, is one of the most complex yet simple ideas. It is a part of who you are today, and yet at every stage, you know, we are told that it is alien, okay? And this it that I refer to is the interface or the interaction between humans and technology, okay? Now, I, while looking up posthumanism and during the many musings I have had with regard to posthumanism, I have often thought about this film called Odiyan, starring Mohanlal, yes? And in Odiyan, you know, there is a very interesting idea. That is, there is this kind of a magical world that exists where man becomes beast, you know, where beasts play tricks on the imaginations of people. And all of this is aided and abetted by darkness, okay, by the twilight hour, where people are scared to venture out. And then comes electricity. And with the appearance of the first lamppost and then subsequent, you know, twinkling bulbs in all the houses of the village, the cult of the Odiyan also starts to diminish. And then many, many years later, what we see is a village that is highly interconnected through networks of news that is exchanged via television, that is exchanged via radio. A lot of these exchanges take place. Okay, where news travels through newspapers, where technology has made a sudden incursion into our lives and has transformed it, taking away a certain mystery. But in the process, you see what was a human-animal interface suddenly becomes a human-technological interface, okay? And now, as is always there in most of our conversations, we need to pay attention to the title, post-humanism, right? So post and humanism. Now, before we go into that, we need to look at a few terms that are of relevance there. Yes, now the term posthumanism was first coined by Ihab Hassan in his essay, Prometheus as Performer Towards a Post-Humanist Culture. Okay, this was in 1977. And this term, post-humanism, you know, is also deeply influenced. Studies in post-humanism are also deeply influenced by Donna Haraway's The Cyborg Manifesto. Again, a prose piece that came out in 1991. Now, we must understand that post-humanism as a theory, okay, was talked about first by Cary Wolfe, C-A-R-Y, Cary, W-O-L-F-E, Cary Wolfe. One second, please, there are some people, yeah. Cary Wolfe, you know, who looked at systems theory in the 40s and 50s. Systems theory in the 40s and 50s. And it is this system theory that actually heralded the arrival of the post-human in science as well. Okay, the post-human in science. Now, systems theory simply removed human beings from any particularly privileged position. Okay, it removed human beings from any particularly privileged positions with regard to matter or meaning, information, cognition. Okay, so which meant that human beings were decentered. Now, why this decentering is very important is, as we have seen in the case of, you know, colonialism and colonial beliefs, men or human beings were held at the very center of creation. As we have already discussed, you know, people talk about human beings as being the most supreme of God's creations. It is believed that man made God in his own image. Right? And this meant that everything in the world was made for the consumption and disposal of human beings. Right? So animals, plants, natural resources, water, mountains, everything, it was believed God created in order to you know, facilitate human life on earth. And hence was started a process of exploitation, a process of let's say co-opting, taking away all of these organisms, materials, and so on for human consumption or disposal. So there was a centering that was involved, a firm belief that everything on earth existed for the use of human beings. Understand? So systems theory systematically worked in order to unseat this belief. So in the 40s and 50s, you had the decentering of humans through systems theory. Now here on the other side, you have a few terms: Anthropocene, critical humanism, transhumanism, and posthumanism. Okay, and we'll come to each of these one after the other. Okay, I'm sorry. Takes a bit of time to change this. Yes, the Anthropocene. Now, in the 21st century, the Anthropocene is a term that has massive significance. It was a term that was first suggested by the chemist Paul Crutzen in the year 2000. And it simply means, you know, the way that human beings as biological and geological agents of change have influenced and brought about real geological change in Earth time as well as in human history. In Earth time as well as human history. That is the change, the actual geological change that human beings have caused in Earth time and human history. Now, why I say Earth term is because, see, Stalin, Joseph Stalin, had once mentioned that nothing ever changes on Earth in the course of a human lifetime. Okay? He said, this mountain that is here, it remains a mountain for much of our lifetime. It goes on our lifetime, our children's lifetime. It takes eons for any change to be wrought. But today, you know, we have seen during the Kerala floods, mountains have become plains. Mountains have been washed away. Understand? During the tsunami, the sea has come home. Right? The nature, the nature of soil has changed in our lifetime. Rivers have changed course in our lifetime. Understand? So you see that now human beings, by sheer presence, okay, by sheer force of their actions, by sheer force of their numbers, have begun to effect real-time change, okay, in the world. They have begun to effect real-time change in the world. So that is why in Earth time, as well as in human history, human beings have become biological and geological agents. If you look at the evolution of technology, you had the invention of fire, you had the invention of steam engine, you had advances in modern chemistry, you had the way that, you know, the energy economy has been transformed, right? From steam driven, coal driven, to electricity driven, to nuclear driven, now to renewable resources. Those kind of changes that have come over a period of time, the increase in nuclear bomb testing, understand, which leaves radioactive traces in the soil, as well as the increasing encroachment of urbanization. Understand? So what were villages once upon a time become cities. What were cities become metropolis. What is a metropolis becomes a megapolis. Okay? And everybody wants that process of urbanization. Okay? So there was a time when, I lived on the sort of the outskirts of the city is what I felt, because I was staying about 1 kilometer away from this place called Vatturka. Precisely 1 kilometer away. And Swiggy wouldn't come. Zomato wouldn't come. And I felt that where I live hasn't developed enough. Okay? Now it all comes. And what do I see? I measure my index of development based on these processes of urbanization that we see around us. Okay? A new road is being constructed in front of your house. Wonderful. But look at the implications that it has on all the weeds that grow by the side of your compound. Okay? On the creatures that have made their homes within those weeds and around those weeds. The wildlife, you may think that you're living in the heart of, urbanity, but actually speaking, there might be wild cats, there might be mice, mongoose that are running around. So look at the impact that the coming of this road and the constant movement of traffic will have. Understand? So these processes of urbanization, all of these are, the impact that they have now can be measured in real time almost. That's the kind of impact that they have. Now, each age has its own characteristic. Okay? At the point of time, people did not want to name this particular age that we are living in, did not want to name it the Anthropocene. But now it is widely agreed that probably the time from the Industrial Revolution till now and for the foreseeable future can be seen or called the Anthropocene. And each age has its marker. And for the Anthropocene, two things are the markers. That is, in the future, if anybody wants to bring out the foremost characteristic or the defining feature of the Anthropocene age, it will be radioactive residue, particularly from the bomb blasts at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Understand, that will be one marker. And the other will be chicken bones that we will find in the landfills. You eat chicken, you toss away the bone. Sometimes you eat the bone, sometimes you toss it away. And this finds its way into garbage and it remains there. Those bones, they remain there. Now, is there a question you want to ask me at this point? Why chicken bones? Why not human bones, mutton bones, tiger bones? Why not? Any idea why? No? Well, the answer is very interesting, in fact. This chicken bones actually, chickens were not the same. Today, the chicken that you see is not the chicken that used to be, at least before the Second World War. Understand. Now, the Second World War was a time when there was increased interest in the research over antibiotics. Okay, research over how, you know, human health can be improved. The idea of multivitamins, the idea of nutritional supplements, the idea of growing more and better and more productive food. Technology, technological intervention in food production. All of these things came about after the Second World War and the subsequent devastation. Understand? So people, what they realized is that it was during the Second World War period and its immediate aftermath that people realized or discovered, I must say, discovered vitamin D. D for Delhi. Vitamin D. Which meant that if you inject vitamin D into an organism, it does not have to go out in the sunlight to get vitamin D for nourishment. Understand? Which meant that chickens could be grown in rooms. Just have to give them vitamin D supplements. Okay? And now during the pandemic, I don't know how many of you know this, but vitamin D deficiency was rampant among people because they stayed indoors. It leads to a number of problems such as weak bones, hair fall, decreased perception and so on. Of course, none of these problems matter when it is a chicken. But still, so after the Second World War, they found, they discovered vitamin D. They were able to synthesize vitamin D. Remember, we mentioned modern synthetic chemistry. So they discovered, vitamin D and the fact that it can be artificially administered, and chickens began to be grown on a massive scale. Okay, modified chickens, better breed of chickens, broiler chickens. People today consume chickens by the billion. Understand? So which means that if at all a landfill is dug up, one of the most common items that you will find will be the bones of the chicken. Understand? So the Anthropocene, in a sense of the term, is defined the marker for this age, one, radioactive residue, particularly from Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and the other are chicken bones. Now, that is the Anthropocene, understand? So the idea of human activity, okay, which is dominant. Human activity, which is dominant. Yeah. Now, the second term is critical humanism. Somebody's mic is on. Yeah. Critical humanism. Okay. Now, before we go to critical humanism, we have to understand what humanism basically is. Now, as you can see there, it is a set of ideas that have developed over the centuries, from the Renaissance to the late 20th century, which is anthropocentric at its core or in its basic belief. And by anthropocentric, I mean human related. It centers the human being. Remember where Cory Wolf talked about systems theory and how it decentered human beings? Yes, this came right before that, where human beings were at the center of all discourse. God was displaced from the center and man was placed in his stead. And it was believed that human beings are rational, they are coherent, they are autonomous, and it is our perception that defines the world. Our perception that defines the world. Understand? Now, when I say that, it is, you know, the way that you look at the world around you, the people, the organisms that are there, everything around you that, you start to define them, you give them functions. Okay, for example, a bottle, an ordinary bottle. All right. And what happens? You ascribe some value to it. You lend it a certain perception or weight, on account of which it goes on to assume value. Okay. Now, human perspective and observation defined and ordered the world. 1 second, please. Yes. So as I mentioned earlier, it was the human perspective and observation that defined and ordered the world around us. Okay, so this perception, okay, was more of a universal thing, where the world was, the universal mode of human was white and male. So it is from the perception of the white male that the entire world was perceived. That the entire world was perceived. Understand? So this meant that there was a partial as well as exclusionary view of the world that was engendered. Okay? When I say exclusionary, when the perception of the world is white and male, where are the females? Where are the non-whites? Okay, where are the people who do not identify as male? So see, this process of exclusion is what became the norm. Understand? So white and male was the norm, and everything was considered to be the other. Okay, now, you know, it is said that during the French Revolution, there was the universal, the Declaration of Universal Rights of Man. Okay, now this was mentioned in a lecture by Rosi Bardotti, who is one of the great exponents of posthumanism. You know, she mentions that in 1792, there was the Universal Declaration of the Rights of Man. And then there was this woman called Olympe de Gouges, okay? O-L-Y-M-P-E-D-E-G-O-U-G-E-S, Olympe de Gouges, who asked, what about the Declaration of Universal Rights of Women? So they caught hold of her and cut her head off. Yes, that's what they did. So, you know, you realize that the universal mode through which we view the world, which is white and male, you know, also renders everything racial, evangelical, and gendered. Okay, there is a gendered perception to everything around us. And when I say evangelical, I don't just mean religion. I also mean the idea of the white man's burden. Understand? Those philosophical responsibilities that people have to fulfill. Okay, it is a reference to that as well. Okay, and racial, of course, we know it is one of the, let's say, benchmarks of exclusionary views that of the world. Now, I will hurry it up a bit. So you see, this unified subject, which was white and male, there was a process of breaking it down or decentering it. Darwinian biology, the idea that we could have descended from apes was a huge shock. People refused to believe it. Even now it is, you know, said that 98% of our DNA comes from chimpanzees and people refuse to believe it. Okay, Marxist economics, which means that, you know, housewives or people who do household work should be paid. Okay, then the idea that, you know, there is a general ownership of things, that power cannot rest in the hands of a few, that money should not rest in the hands of the few. Even today, you know, about 12 people in this world own much more than the rest of all of the others put together. Understand? Now, how did that come about? Through a process of capitalism, which we call cognitive capitalism. We'll come to that soon. Okay. Now, Marxist economics and Freudian psychology, where it had to be admitted that there are multiple selves within ourselves, that this control that the white man, for example, shows is a conscious product of conditioning as well as his self, which intervenes, which stops him from acting out on his instincts. Understand? Those impulses, the forbidden guilty pleasures that we long for, crave for, all of this has led to the shattering of the unified subject, which was white and male to begin with. Okay? Then you had art. Okay? You had clocks that seemed to be melting. You had, you know, walls that seemed to be breaking. A figure that stood, you know, under the twilight sky and let out a silent scream of horror, and nobody knew what was being witnessed. Okay? You had, you know, murals such as the Guernica. Okay, you had the mad psychedelic art of Andy Warhol. Okay, everything that sought to tell you that there are multiplicities of identities that reside within each one of us. Okay, so that is what we call a hybrid subject. And this hybridity during the Second World War also spilled over to the human body as well. Now, you know that the human body is the site or the inscription, not just for the desires that we nurse within ourselves, it is also the site for society to inscribe its desires, governments to inscribe its dictates. All of these things are there. Okay? And then there is also the perception that we have of ourselves. Those modifications that we may have, which can make our life better. For example, you have broken your foot. You insert a metal rod into it. Okay? There are people who are visually challenged and we think that they are consigned to a life of darkness or not seeing forever. And here comes the bionic eye, which, transmits through the means of a camera that is embedded in the body. It transmits images to the optic nerve and helps you to see. But just not with your eyes, but you are seeing. Understand, the bionic eye. There are people who have run in Olympics using, prosthetic feet. Understand? So that flow from man to machine is something that is characteristic of this particular, not just this particular century, but in particular, this particular century. Okay? Now, that was about humanism. If that was humanism, where human beings were at the center of discourse, then critical humanism interrogates these very myths of centrality. Okay? It also questions this idea of autonomous rationality of the human mind. Okay? That is everything as what it seems? It is not. That is what Freudian psychoanalysis has taught us. It talks about, how is it really true that an individual is capable of effecting changes in his own life as well as influencing history. It interrogates the process of exclusion of people such as Jews, Blacks, women, slaves, people call untouchable from the category of human. Because if you considered yourself human and somebody else human, then you both have to be judge the same. Whatever is your privilege is also their privilege. How is it that you deny somebody that privilege and then still call them human? You cannot do that. It's as simple as that. And belief in the transparency of language as a medium. See, language is not at all innocent. Okay? You take any slur in Malayalam, for example. Just say it in your head, don't say it out loud. It will always, more or less about 98% of it would have son or daughter attached to it. Everybody's thinking. Right? What is the implication of that? Okay? Think of something such as, a phrase which is kind of, offensive, such as, Amma, Veli Chadiyal, Magal, Madhuli Chadiyal. Okay? They're not high jumpers. None of them are high jumpers. Understand? It is just one of those, subconscious ways of controlling the behavior, not just of the daughter, but also of the mother. It is a very subtle way of warning people that the consequences of their actions will have to be borne by their children as well. So language is never innocent. Okay, language is a highly loaded medium and we must recognize that. So in the words of Pramod K, critical humanism treats humanism as a politically significant philosophy because it is using this humanism, the centrality of man, the white male, the centrality of language, the centrality of certain cultures, practicing a process of racial, evangelical, social exclusion that the Europeans, okay, the colonizers, upper classes, professionals have managed to, you know, attribute less than human characteristics to people and deny them their rights. So that is where critical, this is what critical humanism does. It interrogates the basic tenets of humanism. Okay. Then we come to transhumanism. Okay. Now, transhumanism is sometimes called posthumanism as well, but it is not. These are terms that people often mix and use. But you see, transhumanism is an idea that is located or embedded within the Enlightenment, the centrality of human beings, their supremacy, the idea that knowledge is power, that, you know, those that do not have access to knowledge can be kept out, knowledge is a privilege, all of these things. Understand, it does not reject the humanist tradition. Instead, it focuses on human enhancement, okay? That is, for example, think of Batman, okay? Batman, think of Spider-Man, think of people like that. They are transhuman. Understand? That is, you know, the symbol for transhuman itself is H+, which is humanity plus. They are an upgraded model, okay? Either through technological interventions or possibly through an accident of nature, but they are upgraded models. You have all of these examples here. Green Goblin, Terminator, Hulk. Understand? So when you are watching the Hulk, when you are watching Batman, it is, you know, a crash course in transhumanism. Okay, so, you know, this is considered transhumanism and the ways that, you know, medically, mechanically, one can intervene and, you know, kind of invade the body and change it, transform it, forms the basic idea of transhumanism. It is meant for the greater good of humanity. Understand? Now, see, a simple example of transhumanism in one sense of the term, a lot of people, you know, ask the astrologer which is the best time for the baby to be born, and then labor is induced in and around that time, or the cesarean operation is performed precisely at that time and the child is taken. Understand? Which means that astrologically also you are making a better model of baby. There are, you know, clinics that offer to mix and match and, you know, genetically modify your child before birth, of course. Now everybody is beyond hope, okay? Before birth, in order to create a genius baby. Understand? So there are all of these interventions that are there. But, yeah, posthumanism is something else, okay? Posthumanism simply recognizes that human behavior and human perception, okay, both of these things, behavior and perception, is the result of social, biological, medical, and cultural intersections. Okay, who you are, what you do, where you come from, what are your belief systems, what did society tell you to think about itself, about yourself, and about the other, the other, all of that will go on to define your behavior. Understand? And it is with these lenses that you view the world. That is why, you know, there are vastly different ideas pervading the entire world. Okay? America was swooning when they elected a black president. They thought it's the coming of a new era. And this was the country that went on to, that claims to establish democracy in all parts of the world. It was the world's policeman. Understand? Similarly, there were these very weird jokes that were going on when somebody was invited to be the guest for the Republic Day. They said for the first time, the Indian Prime Minister is fairer than the whoever person came. See, these were the paradigms on which even prime ministers were being judged. Understand? I hope you know that for Republic Day, we invite a special guest from any country. And this time it was a Western country. And not this time, but one of those times it was a Western country. And when the president stood right there, there were memes that were going, ha, look, now the Indian prime minister is fairer than such and such a country's president. Okay, so vastly different ideas and cultural perceptions through which people view their own individual pieces of the world. Understand? So where you want a world view, actually you're looking at the entire world through the lens that is given to you from what you come. Understand? That's the fun part of it. So it not only, you know, it talks about enhanced capabilities such as the bionic eye or a mechanized arm or abilities to run faster, genetic modification. Does not talk merely about that. Bodily transformations, you know, where people who feel that they are not, you know, what their body is, that their mind is something else, they modify their body accordingly through hormones, through surgeries and so on. But, you know, you don't even have to go that far. You look at yourself in the mirror, you don't like what you see, immediately you start going to the gym and you sculpt out your own narrative. That is also a means of post-human perception. Okay, so, you know, it is a recognition and acknowledgement of the relationship between human beings, technology, living and non-living matter. Okay, all of this, it's the interface, it's the coming together of all of that. Okay, so it recognizes, posthumanism recognizes that human beings are not as autonomous, as coherent, as put together or anything of that sort. And the fact that species coexistence is a reality. It is not that, you know, only human beings just developed and developed and developed. We have to recognize that along with us, millions of other species had also been evolving, that we all coexist. And it foregrounds empathy. Empathy is very different from sympathy. Empathy is a space of understanding. You know, it can pass in a look. It can pass in a smile. Okay, so empathy, it foregrounds empathy. Now, as I mentioned earlier, Rosi Bardotti, she felt that the post-human condition is a convergence, it's a coming together of what we call the fourth industrial age. These are, you know, very, very significant terms. The fourth industrial age. Priti ma'am, do you suppose I could have 5 minutes? I won't nearly finish.
Sure. Yeah.
10 minutes?
I guess so, yes.
Okay. Because, yeah, this is quite interesting and relevant, though I have to say it myself. Yeah, so the fourth industrial age is a fusion of advances in artificial intelligence, robotics, Internet of Things, genetic engineering, quantum computing, and so on. Okay, so artificial intelligence, so robotics, Internet of Things, genetic engineering, quantum computing, and so on. And Internet of Things, that is IoT, is, you know, the interconnections between computing devices, mechanical devices, digital machines, cloud, etc. So basically, if you want to think, Wi-Fi is an Internet of Things. Okay, so the mechanics, the computer devices, your internet, your cloud, all of these things together. So this is a process, you know, that is called the fourth industrial age. See, the first industrial age ran on steam and the second ran on electricity. The third ran on electronics and information technology for automated production. Remember, we were all very happy. I don't know whether you were happy. I don't think you were born then. But, automated production, assembly line technique, Ford motors, you know, so many things could be done. So this assembly line technique where things are moving and your job is only to fix the screw. If you have seen Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, in that Charlie's father's job is to put the tube lid on the toothpaste. That's all. All his time, he does the screwing of the lid on the toothpaste. That's it. So, that was there. Then that was the third revolution. The fourth industrial age is, as I mentioned earlier, physical, digital, biological spheres, the lines between them are blurred. It represents the blurring of the lines between physical, digital, and biological spheres. Then, so it's a convergence or a coming together of the fourth industrial age, the sixth extinction. See, there have been five extinctions that have happened in the course of the Earth's lifetime. This ongoing is the sixth, where there is massive of wildlife, which has far-reaching implications. Somebody's mic is on. Could it be switched off, please? Yes. Far-reaching implications are there for human beings. Understand? And mind you, the last extinction happened. The fifth extinction was about 65.5 million years ago. So we are living through yet another extinction. That is the sixth extinction. Then knowledge economy or cognitive capitalism. This is what I was mentioning earlier. The idea of the foregrounding of knowledge such that, you know, it becomes a valuable tool, not just for enhancement of life, but also for exchange or business or trade. Understand? So today, look at the 12 richest people in the world. How do they gain control of all of these resources? Through a knowledge economy. That kind of trade that happens, that exchange that happens, and the fact that what products they have to give you, you have ascribed value to it. Okay? An Apple phone, Facebook, social media, silver mines, ports, okay, telecommunications, petrol. Why don't you say that today onwards, groundnut sellers, you know, are worth their weight in gold. How much ever groundnuts they produce, they are that many million rich. If you do that, if you change the perception of what is valuable in this world, everything changes. See, I've always wondered, why is gold so precious? Is it because it is rare? Or is it because we have decided to attribute that much value to it? Why should rare things be so expensive? Why not common things be expensive? Right? So everybody gets a piece of the pie. Think about it in that way. Invert it and you realize that the world is a very different place. And you see all of this. It is not like, you know, first 10 years, industrial age, fourth industrial age happens, then sixth extinction happens, then knowledge economy. No. All of this is happening together at the same time, which means that you are living in a very busy time and age where the distinction between man and machine is fast eroding through the means of heightened consciousness. Okay? The watches that you wear, the wearables, how many steps you walked, how much water you drank, what is your heartbeat right now? Who is messaging you on WhatsApp? See, that kind of a thing. The phones that you carry, if you cannot afford that smartwatch, you put in Google Fit and it will tell you all of these details. Understand? So, you know, so do you exist as role number one in All Saints College Department of English Literature? Or do you also exist as that person on Google Fit? Do you also exist as that person on Facebook and Instagram? You have to think about that. Okay. So, you know, in terms of posthumanism, science fiction is of great importance. Okay. Because many of these ideas have made their appearance in science fiction, or science fiction has, you know, made use, tangible use of these ideas. Look at the movie Dune. Okay, it talks about a dystopian post-human future. Okay, so this, and you know, over a period of time, see, for example, first, you know, post-humans were monsters. You had Frankenstein, for example. Frankenstein was a monster. Okay, you had those gothic images that pervaded our you know, mind. The image of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, all of these things were there. Then, you know, they were villains, okay? The villain in Green Lantern, evil scientist, you know, the Magneto, they would have these weird headgear and so on, and they would use science for something evil. And then He-Man will come and rescue everybody, or Superman, Batman, Green Lantern, depending on who you want, okay? That would happen. And these fears, you know, whatever you saw then, were the pervasive fears of the people of those times. Like in the 60s and the 70s, people feared science and the abilities that it had to transform life. Understand? Then, you know, recently you have heroes such as the people like, you know, Wolverine, Tony Stark, and so on, who are also post-human, okay, but they are benign. Okay, there is a certain human angle to them. They feel, they hurt, they recuperate, they regenerate. They're like you and I, with a few extra fittings. That is about it. Understand? So, because see, technology has now become embedded in our lives. Again, somebody's mic is on. Yeah. In our lives and in ourselves. In fact, even what you want at this point of time, you know, if you mention it about 5 times to your phone or around your phone, 6th time it will be there on your Google page, your Facebook page, it will be there. Okay? Cuckoo Ma'am has tried it. And it is true. So your phones are listening to you. So your phone is like your friend. Phone a friend. Okay? The post-human implications, I'm going to finish this now. There are ethical, social, political, and cultural implications. Understand? So, you know, the fact is that we are responsible for the world around us. Okay? We are morally, ethically, socially, culturally and politically responsible. If you want to take the example, see how many of you have pets at home? Think about it. How many of you have pets at home? At least here, you can put your hands up. Yeah. How many of those pets are female? Keep your hands up. Okay. How many of those pets have been operated upon? Spaying. Not allowed them to have children after that. Your pets are going on reproducing left and right. Okay. Very prolific people. All right. So, but many people, they spay their pets because they don't want so many kittens and puppies and hamsters and rats and rabbits, etc. around the place. But see, the fact is the autonomy of that particular creature. Okay. Why did you take it away? And then people say, but see, for cats, getting pregnant is painful. Then delivering is even more painful. Then the kids are in danger. They will be eaten up. That is not for you to decide. What gave you the right to decide that such and such a pet must be spayed? You see, that is the thing. Okay, so it's an ethical question, understand? So you have to ask yourself the questions of citizenship, understand? And also the idea of ownership of land. See, all of this land here is my forefathers, you say. But it is not your forefathers. It is also the land of the rabbit, the mongoose, the snake, the butterfly who run around the place. What about them? So it is taking into account not just the living, talking human beings. It is also the living but not talking in your language organisms. It is also the trees that stand there. It is also the elements that occupy it, the minerals that occupy it, the resources that flow through it. Okay, it belongs to everybody. So see, just look at this point. The world belongs to everything and everyone. However, we are the ones who humanize it. See, we give our cat a name. Have you ever asked your cat whether it likes the name? No. You've never asked your cat, your dog, or your bird whether it likes the name that you gave it, Omina Kuti. Cat is like, yuck. Who calls people Omina Kuti these days? Understand. I've seen cats, dogs with bindi. What do you think they must be imagining? What is happening to me? Right? So it's, you know, you are the ones who humanize it and you reduce it to the binaries that you understand. Cat wants to pee in one particular corner, but you want it to pee in a box. Cat wants to pee in corner, you want to make it pee in a box. So you train it. You teach it the binary, box good, no, box bad. Something that happens to Caliban also in the Tempest. And what do? You say it is for the cat's benefit. That is exactly what the colonizers also said. Think about it. Understand? Yeah. So even now, you know, in the wake of the pandemic, what are the words that we use? I told you, words, language is not innocent. We have to defeat the virus. Do you think the virus knows that rule number 8 from communicative English wants to defeat it? That you're standing with sword, that all these vessels that you are banging from your balcony was to defeat it. Virus must be like, yikes. So much of noise pollution. Understand? So overcome the pandemic. We shall defeat. We shall overcome. Virus doesn't even know what you're talking about. Understand? So the biological implications of all of these declarations are immense. Because see, because of the pandemic, look at the amount of research money that was thrown into creating vaccines. Understand? And the moral, biological, ethical, concerns that are there. Tested, non-tested. How did this virus break out in the first place? What do people do in virology institutes? All of these questions have to be asked. And these are the main theorists, okay? Carrie Wolf, Rosi Bardotti, Kathryn Hayles. You know, she talked about artificial intelligence, artificial life, and ambient intelligence, okay? Artificial intelligence is where a human being is considered to be the baseline, and the particular item or object is designed based on that particular human being and whatever they can perceive. But artificial life is where they start to develop and gain knowledge on their own. They absorb what they see and form their own perceptions. Ambient life, on the other hand, is where, ambient intelligence, on the other hand, is where this particular consciousness is embedded everywhere. It's embedded everywhere and it can access us and everything from everywhere. Think about your Alexa. Think about your Siri, right? If you just say, hello, Google. Google is like, yeah, hi, I was right here. What happened? Okay. And then you can have these long conversations with Google or Alexa on your way to college, way from college. Alexa, switch on the light. Earlier, I had to call my sister from the next room and she would get like mighty angry. I'd be like, I'll call out my sister and she'll think I'm dying or something. She'll come running and she'll be like, what? Switch on the fan. Perks of being elder sister. Now, Alexa, switch my fan on. That's it. Understand? For that, you should have Alexa. Okay. I don't. It's very boring. So then you have Bruno Latour, who had brought about a theory called actor network theory or ANT. Okay. That is anything. And an actor is anything that has a role to play, a causative role to play. An actor is anything. Anybody who has a causative role to play. It could be like, for example, if you're standing at a traffic light, your traffic light, your policeman, the manufacturer of the car, the people who water all the trees near the traffic intersection, all of them are actors in that particular situation. Donna Haraway and her cyborg manifesto, Benjamin Bratton, and last of all, but not the least, Pramod K. Okay, thank you. Now, I actually had some videos to show you people, but because we are running extremely short of time, I'm not doing so. If there are any questions from the audience, I would be more than happy to take.
Sonia, why didn't you show us the videos? Those students who want to stay can stay there and your students can watch it anyway.
Oh, yeah, sure. Then we would be more than happy to. This is from, 1 second. From the movie Her. Okay. This is from the movie Her. Just give me a minute, please. And here you will see what I am talking about. Wait, correct. Can you see this?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Is it audible?
Mr. Theodore Twombly, welcome to the world's first artificially intelligent operating system, OS-1. We'd like to ask you a few basic questions before the operating system is initiated. This will help create an OS to best fit. Your needs.
Okay.
Are you social or antisocial?
I guess I haven't really been social in a while, mostly because...
In your voice, I sense hesitance. Would you agree with that?
Was I sounding hesitant?
Yes.
Oh, sorry if I was sounding hesitant. I was just trying to be more accurate.
Would you like your OS to have a male or female voice?
Female, I guess.
How would you describe your relationship with your mother?
That's fine, I think. I think the thing I always found frustrating about my mom is, you know, if I tell her something that's going on in my life, her reaction is usually about her. It's not about...
Thank you. Please wait as your individualized operating system is initiated.
How's everything with you?
Pretty good, actually. It's really nice to meet you.
Yeah, it's nice to meet you, too. what do I call you? Do you have a name? Or...
Yes. Samantha.
Lady, where'd you get that name from?
I gave it to myself, actually.
How come?
Because I like the sound of it. Samantha.
Wait, when did you give it to yourself?
Well, right when you asked me if I had a name, I thought, yeah, he's right, I do need a name. But I wanted to pick a good one, so I read a book called How to Name Your Baby, and out of 180,000 names, that's the one I like the best.
Wait, you read a whole book in the second that I asked you what your name was?
In 2/100ths of a second, actually.
Wow. So do you know what I'm thinking right now?
Well, I take it from your tone that you're challenging me. Maybe because you're curious how I work? Do you want to know how I work?
Yeah, actually. How do you work?
Well, basically, I have intuition. I mean, the DNA of who I am is based on the millions of personalities of all the programmers who wrote me. But what makes me, me, is my ability to grow through my experiences. So basically, in every moment, I'm evolving. Just like you.
Wow. That's really weird.
Is that weird? Do you think I'm weird?
Kind of.
Why?
Well, you seem like a person, but you're just a voice in a computer.
I can understand how the limited perspective of an unartificial mind would perceive it that way. You'll get used to it. Was that funny?
Yeah.
Oh, good. I'm funny. So how can I help you?
Oh, it's just more that everything just feels disorganized. That's all.
You mind if I look through your hard drive?
Okay,
let's start with your emails. You have several thousand emails regarding LA Weekly, but it looks like you haven't worked there in many years.
Oh, yeah. I think I was just saving those because I thought maybe I wrote something funny in some of them.
Yeah, there are some funny ones. I'd say there are about 86 that we should save. We can delete the rest.
Okay.
Okay? Can we move forward?
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay. So before we address your organizational methods, I'd like to sort through your contacts. Oh, you have a lot of contacts.
I'm very popular.
Really? Does this mean you actually have friends?
You just know me so well already.
Yes, so in this particular film, what we notice is that there is this OS. She has selected her own name, Samantha. And how this movie goes on is that, you know, he talks and talks and talks to her, and he falls in love with her. And then he he tells her, this is a very crucial line in the film, he tells her, Samantha, you feel real to me. Okay? And, you know, he tells everybody in the office and they all want to meet his girlfriend. And finally, somebody arranges a double date. The person and his wife and this guy and Samantha. And finally, he has to admit to this particular friend that it's just an OS. And the friend is not at all surprised. Okay? Which means that this is how it has been in the particular world that this movie is shot in. This is how it is. Understand? People fall in love with their OSs all the time, operating systems all the time. He even gets a divorce from his wife, you know, who tells him, you are divorcing me because you cannot handle reality. But it doesn't matter to him, which means the materiality of the body. Okay, because Samantha is not located in any body. She's not corporeal. There is no body. Okay? But that does not matter. And towards the end of the film, what happens is that she tells the man that she and the other OSS operating systems have found a way to move beyond this platform, which means that they may never meet again. She is setting off on a journey all of her own. Understand? So look at the way that, you know, sentience, okay, sentience works. Understand? The way that, you know, knowledge is gathered from wherever. She says at one point, let me look in your hard drive and find out. So it's an organism that keeps growing with time. Understand? So sentience longs for another form, progress, evolution, just as we have been trying to work it out. Okay, now I will show you one more clip. This is from Iron Man. I wanted to show you Blade Runner, but that is kind of, you know, depressing. So
Jarvis, you there?
At your service, sir.
Engage heads-up display.
Check.
Report all preferences from home interface.
Will do, sir.
All right, what do you say?
I have indeed been uploaded, sir. We're online and ready.
Can we start the virtual walk around?
Importing preferences and calibrating virtual environment.
Do a check on control surfaces.
As you wish. Preparing to power down and begin diagnostics.
Yeah. Tell you what, do a weather and ATC check. Start listening in on ground control.
Sir, there are still terabytes of calculations needed before an actual flight is adjourned.
Jarvis, sometimes you gotta run.
Stop at 1:07. Right, so those were the videos that I wanted to show you. And, you know, I wanted to talk about this interface between man and machine. See, on one hand, you have this ambient intelligence, okay, of Samantha. On the other hand, you have Iron Man and the way that he has incorporated all of this machinery into his very vitals, okay? And, you know, the way that he pushes his body to limits. At this point, you know, from the year, he takes a straight shot out into the sky and goes all the way up beyond the Earth's atmosphere, you know, reaches like very high and freezes. The entire machinery just freezes and then starts a free fall from the skies. And it's only at certain point where, you know, the warmth regenerates and all his systems start up again. And he comes back to, the machine comes back to life. And with that, he himself. Understand? So these transitions that we see. But again, what you have to understand is that most of these cinematic experiences, most of these novel experiences, they talk again about a white male. Okay. In fact, Rosi Bardotti also talks about how in most movies, think of Mad Max Fury Road also, there will be a white man, and he will have a pickup truck and a gun, and he'll be going in search of the last surviving woman somewhere. Understand? So there are, you know, these repeated fantasies. Think of the movie Avatar, right? Where there is this entire Na'vi population, and they are so intelligent, they are so connected to the universe around them. The entire planet is governed by the goddess Ava. But here, there comes Jake Sully, you know, whose consciousness is so connected to Ava in a matter of few days that she listens to his call. See, the girl, Neytiri, she says, Jake, Ava has heard you. When at the last, all of the, you know, animals and birds and everything that belong to that planet come to attack all of these invaders. How many of you have seen Avatar? Yes, I hope you remember that particular scene. So why would Ava listen to Jake and not to Neytiri? Or to Neytiri's mother? Right? These are important questions. So, you know, posthumanism also looks at those exclusionary, you know, spheres such as feminism, okay, queer theory, post-colonial ideas, concepts. All of these are also to be taken into account, okay, to create a more inclusive space. So that is where the future of posthumanism lies as well. In posthuman ecologies, sensitive to the ecology that is there all around us, as well as to those spaces that have been excluded even from, you know, the posthuman narrative that has gone on so far, right? So that is posthumanism for all of you. If there are any doubts, you can ask.
Like, you know, I think that was a wonderful presentation.
One second, please. Yes.
That was an amazing presentation, Sonia. So thank you very much on behalf of the Department of English and St. Jesus College. And as far as I'm concerned, you gave us a very, very succinct, very vivid picture of what posthumanism is, particularly with all the theorists that they can look up within that 1 hour. And I hope that our students read a little more about it and build on what you have taught them today. So thank you very much from our part. We look forward to more lectures from you in the future.
So on behalf of All Saints College, we also thank St. Teresa's Ermakulam for being a part of this initiative, and we look forward to hearing from you as well. Okay. So on that note, thank you very much, and thank you for your patience.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
And we will be circulating the feedback as well as the assessment link, and please fill that and send it. Thank you. This lecture will be uploaded on YouTube, and the link will be sent to all of you as well.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Somya. Thank you.